After your last fight with Emiliano Massolini, you considered quitting the ring. You know, where are you now from that stage at the beginning of the year?
It's crazy, you know, boxing, it's about ups and downs in life, and, you know, I've had an excellent career so far, and, you know, I was considering whether to call it a day or, you know, whether to fight on again. You know, at the end of the day, I've got a family to look after, and I've got two beautiful kids who, you know, I want the best for, and I want them to see me happy. And then I got a phone call with the chance to fight Anthony Crolla for the British title, which, in my eyes, I had to take, I had to jump on it. I mean, I've seen on a couple of boxing forums that I've took the fight for money and stuff like that, which is, in my eyes, and my camp's eyes, it's just stupid. Because at the end of the day, I've spent a lot of money in this training camp, you know, and I've changed trainers, I've gone back to where I started with Danny Vaughan and George Vaughan, and, you know, I'm back to where I want to be, I'm happy again. And as George always told me, a happy fighter is a good fighter, and I believe I'm back. And, you know, to me it won't be a shock, but to the boxing world it might be a shock when I beat Anthony Crolla.
My last hard day at the office, all the hard work's been done, prepared right. You can see for yourself how fit I am and how strong I feel. A couple of pounds over the weight, everything's good, everything's going smooth.
People might make a lot of that weight, might they? But is it lightweight then you feel?
I'm massive, I made the weight easy. I've had two check weigh-ins with the boxing board. I'm well under the weight, I've never failed on the scales ever before.
Now training there in Liverpool. Prior to that, you was in Manchester with Oliver Harrison. What was the thought behind moving back up here?
I just felt, you know, I got a bit stale under Oliver, and, you know, not to do with Oliver. He's a tremendous coach. He's a world class coach in my eyes. You know, look what he's done for me. I would turn my career around, and I'd never have a bad word to say about him. And we've left on personal terms, on good terms. You know, he's on the phone to me every other day, or I'm on the phone to him, dropping him a text, and he's asking how training's going, how's everything going with Danny and everything. So, you know, that's what kind of person I am. You know, if I'm going to leave someone, I like to leave on a good note, and I've left him on a good note. And, you know, I've never had a bad word to say about him. He's a top coach. And then there was only one other man who wanted to train me for this fight. You know, without blowing my own trumpet or sounding together, but I think he could have went to any of the coaches in Britain at the moment. You know, I'm fighting for a British title fight, and I spoke to Stephen, who manages me, and I said, well, I'm going to fight for the British title. I'm only going to do it if Danny will accept to be my coach, and if Danny will train me for the fight. And I rang Danny and he said, yeah, let's do it, but you do it in my terms. And that's what I've done. I've gone away. Danny's locked myself away in Scotland. He's looked after me up there. And, you know, I'm locked away in an apartment, which was done by a sponsor. And, you know, everything's going great. The sparring's going great so far. The training up there, locked away from home, locked away from the family. The sacrifice I've had to do is killing me, you know what I mean? But, you know, come fight night, I know it's going to pay off. And I can thank everyone, you know, for helping me out.
You know, like you say, Danny, you have a close relationship with him, and he does know you the best out of anyone. Did you feel like, you know, this important fight at such a critical time in your career, there was no one else better to be with you at this stage?
I wouldn't have went with anyone else, it was simple as that. I wouldn't have took the fight if Danny wouldn't have accepted to say him, you know. And he, trainers and coaches, you need a click, and me and Danny have got it with his dad, George, as well. You know, who better than to win a British title with? Because I know I'm going to win it, and I'm going to win it for myself and for them. You know, what they've done from the start of my career, and what I'm going to do at the end of my career, is, you know, I owe a lot to them. And, you know, you need a click, and as I said, I get a buzz off Danny, we bounce off each other, the atmosphere in the gym's good. You know, me and him could just be in there on our own, but we have a crack when the training's getting done. It's all about the serious work, and then, you know, the banter's at the end, and it's good, I'm enjoying it.
You did retire in 2009 after defeat to Scott Lawton. You know, that was it for you, Derry. Well, I know we spoke just when you made this comeback, but this part of your career now, it's almost been unexpected, but you know, a very successful second chapter of your career.
It's been a roller coaster, you know, it's crazy. I mean, it's one I always look back at, you know, since I've retired and I've come back. I've boxed for a European title, which in my eyes is a massive achievement. I've boxed for a world title, I've boxed, IBO international champion, a British Masters champion, and I've also, you know, I've won the English title, sorry, the second time at lightweight, and I'm fighting for the British title under the coaches where I first started. Well, who else has done that? Who else has done what I've done in Liverpool? And, you know, I'm proud of it, and I hope the coaches and I hope everyone who backs me is proud of it.
Do you see this now, you know, your last chance to do something in your career? Is this, you know, you never fought for a British title before. It'd be, you know, it could be the beginning of another chapter again. Do you see it like that?
This is the, I hope it's, no, I know for a fact, I mean, you know, I've trained hard, I've prepared right, done everything right, from my diet right through my sleeping plan, everything's gone perfect. And this is going to be a new start under Danny again. So, you know, so it's chapter three, but, you know, I want to win a British title and I want to win it outright, and that'll be some achievement by myself and what I've done with Danny, and, you know, that is the goal. And I know for a fact, if the right Derry Mathews turns up, there's no way Anthony Crolla's going to live with me. And a lot of people might say, oh, he doesn't know what he's talking about, he's finished, he's at the end of his career, but just wait till fight night when that bell goes and he's on his own, and I'm going to take him places he's never been took before.
Do you feel they're underestimating you? They're overlooking you, Derry?
I hope they are. I hope everyone in Britain's underestimating me, because I know I'm right. My coach knows I'm right. Danny and Paul Weir know I'm right. And my dietitian, James Morton, everything's right. Everything's gone superb. My personal life's perfect. You know, obviously I've sacrificed living away from my girlfriend and my kids for 8 weeks. But, you know, come fight night, I want to be in that ring. I want to think what I've sacrificed, what I've gone through to be in here. And wait till you see the decision at the end, because in my eyes, there's only one winner, and I'm going to bully him, I'm going to box him, I'm going to do whatever I have to do to win the fight, I'm going to win that British title fight.
Now you are training with Danny. He's based in Scotland, Danny, now, so you've been up there working out. What's that added to, you know, can you tell us about that, working in Scotland?
It's just, you know, in Scotland, I'm just locked away, home to bed at 9 o'clock, no TV in my room, no luxuries like that. It's just bed at 9 o'clock, I'm up at 5 o'clock for running. We're staying right next door to Danny's house, so, you know, we don't have to travel far. I picked up for the gym at 12, I'm in the gym for 2.5 hours, and, you know, we'll go maybe on the pitch the other night, go and have a game of snooker pool, and I'm back, as I said, I'm back in bed for 9 o'clock. I'm eating, living and sleeping, drinking and boxing, do you know what I mean? I'm doing everything right, my diet's perfect, I'm getting the best foods, I'm locked away, I'm the sacrifice, my phone's turned off, come 8 o'clock. And, you know, I'm just living the dream, I'm just doing it, and I know for a fact that everything what I'm doing in Scotland, the sacrifices, it's going to pay off.
And you're right up here.
I'm right, and my mind's right, my body's right. Come fight, my body's not right now, but in 4 weeks' time, 3 weeks' time, I'll be more than right, you know. I'm just doing the second part of my sparring now, and everything's couldn't have gone better, you know. No injuries, no niggles, no nothing, just everything's gone perfect.
And am I right to say, straight from Scotland, you flew over to Lanzarote, and you've been training out there as well, you and Danny. So that's another, you know, another thing to you.
Yeah, it's just it's something I've never done. I've never had the opportunity to do it. And Danny said to me, "We're going to Lanzarote." But in 5 days, I knew I was going to Lanzarote. You know, so it's about adapting. And as soon as I got there, I loved it. You know, I was locked away. No distractions again. It's a bit like Scotland, but a lot warmer. It's a lot of mountain running and stuff like that. But, you know, I enjoyed it. The travelling weren't too bad. It's only a few hour flight. We were there, locked away, running on the mountains, in the gym in the afternoon, kept everything really the same times. And being crazy as it is out there as well, the heat, I dropped a lot of weight, so my weight's perfect. Everything's under control. I've got a check weigh in this week, and, you know, I say it couldn't be better, it couldn't be where I want to be. I'm in the right frame of mind, my body's right, and come fight night, you'll see.
You had the weather over there. Did you do the altitude training and running up the mountains?
Yeah, well, I think just being out there is altitude in itself. I mean, you're above sea level on the. We do this, what's called like a mountain, like a coast road, mountain road, which is, it's very, very hard. You know, maybe 6-7 mile, but we're going for it 4 days out of 7. Proper hard stuff. And then the other couple of days we were on a beach, which was also killing our legs and stuff like that. But, you know, it's the sacrifices. Done all the hard work, all the long runs done,
it's just all about the sprint work now, using the running sacks, which I've never used before. So I'm good on them in the next couple of weeks, so you know, it's going to be good.
And Anthony Crolla, you know, his strengths, his weaknesses, you're studying him. And does he keep you awake at night? Are you confident that you're the man who can end this run and take his title?
There's no one better to be the fighting Georgie Vaughan, who's Danny's dad, who coached me from the start. So he's had the DVDs. I just listen to what he has to say to Danny, what Danny does into me, and I'll go from there. I've seen Crolla grow. I've grew up with Crolla, the same, like, you know, the same, around the same age, and being on the same amateur shows and stuff like that. So I'll be honest, I'm not against him. He's a wonderful lad. He's a great lad. He's a great champion. And I'll never disrespect any fighter. He's a gentleman away from the boxing ring, but you know, just, has he ever been it? That's what comes into my mind. Has he ever been cut? I wouldn't say so. Has he ever been in a hard fight? No, but okay, he boxed Michael Brody, but come on, the way to say Michael Brody, what we all know, against the box Chi and stuff like that, you know. Michael Brody's a tremendous, tremendous fighter, but the night he boxed Andy Crolla, it weren't him. John Watson, who's a personal friend of mine, my good friend, I spoke to John about it. He was dead at the weight. And Willie Limmons, who, in my eyes, he was 30 years of age, and I think he's called it a day, and that was his last fight, and he just never turned up, Willie Limmons, because I believe if a proper Willie Limmons would have turned up, he'd have beat Andy Crolla. So, you know, he's there for the taking. He's never been in a hard fight, and I'm going to give him one of the hardest fights he's ever going to have in his life, and, you know, maybe he might want to drop down to super featherweight, where I believe he belongs. And the reason he is British champion is because I was cut in training. Well, sorry, I was cut in the Scott Lawton fight.
I was meant to fight. I was going to fight John Watson, and I got a bad cut, which reeled me out. And Anthony Crolla stepped in to fight John Watson, and Anthony Crolla won the British title. So, in my eyes, he's keeping it warm for me.
So in a way, it's destiny come round. It's for
it's
you.
Destiny. I got out the beans when I boxed Scott Lawton. And I was going to fight 2 weeks later for the British title, only the boxing boards gave me 28 days with a bad cut on my head. Or I'd have took the fight like that to fight John Watson, because I knew personally John Watson weren't right at the weight, and you know, I would have been British champion, and everyone would have been talking about me the way they're talking about Anthony. So, you know, he's only British lightweight champion because he got given an opportunity. I've been given an opportunity, and I'm not going to let it slip.
You're talking about like this second period of your career, you know, during it you avenged the Scott Lawton, Choi, won the English title, so you had the big Stephen Jennings Liverpool derby, and you earned this shot at the IBO in your last fight. Obviously prior to that was Gavin Rees. Tell me about them last two fights. He was, you know, that the Gavin Rees fight was very unlucky. The last fight, how did you feel that went?
In the Gavin Rees fight, I just, you know, everything went right, my training and everything, you know, no excuses. I turned up on the night to win the fight, and I thought I was winning the fight, and, you know, it was a stupid clash of heads, and I thought it was a deliberate clash of heads, and I've gone and watched it over and over again, and I still think it was deliberate, but, you know, I'm not making no excuses. Gavin is a tremendous fighter. He's a proven fighter, you know, he's a former world champion, the weight above, and you think he's lost one out of 37 fights. He's still the European champion, but, you know, things happen in boxing for a reason. Things happen in life for a reason. And then the fight after that, Marcelli, I had a bad nose going into the camp. My nose was still a mess, and everything was just all niggles and stuff like that. But, you know, taking that away from him, Marcelli, he turned up on the night. He was an awkward southpaw, unbeaten, come to win, you know. And the better man won on the night. And believe it or not, he fixed my nose for me, straightened my nose. Because before after the Rees fight, sorry, I couldn't touch my nose and sparring, it was hurting and stuff like that. I couldn't really do any sparring for it. I think I'd done a couple of rounds, and halfway through the Marcelli fight it went again, but we've had it checked. I've been seeing a specialist, I've seen the best people out there, and they've checked in and said, believe it or not, the Italians put it back into place for you. He straightened it out, and I've had no nosebleed in sparring, and I'm getting fully hit on the nose. So everything's right, you know, this British title fight, I just couldn't have come at a better time. Everything's gone right, and I'm here to prove a lot of people wrong.
So he's at you, you knocked it right,
yeah,
in
it,
the right?
It was weird, because my nose was sort of over this side, and every time I'd squeeze on it, it really hurt, it was tender. So as he's clashed heads, I think he's popped it back in, and that's what, the bleeding. And if you see my face the next day, I was a mess, my black eyes, my nose was up. but all of a sudden it's back to normal and the nose is back. I mean, it might look normal, but it is normal, and you know what I mean. Come fight night, it'll be ready for the war.
I thought he was doing all right in that fight. You wobbled him as well a couple of times.
The referee never done me no favours. I've looked at that back as well, and you know, if that would have been in Italy, and I was all over the place with the Italian referee, stopped me. I had to say so, yeah. So he could have helped me out a bit, but you know, I'm lucky enough that I've got a British title fight at the back end of that fight. And you know, if you look at my career, I've only been beaten the best. And I've boxed the best, I'm not afraid to say it. I'll box anyone, it's the way I am. I'm from Liverpool, I'll fight anyone out there. I've always been beat off the best, and the better man's won on the night. I've had no excuses. You know, people saying stuff weren't right at home, and stuff like that. So when they get beat, make an excuse up, they have bad hands. If things aren't right at home, or you've got bad hands going into the fight, don't take the fights. That's what I've always said, and you know, I'm here, I've done everything right. I've had no excuses, come fight night. I'll be British champion, there's no doubt in that.
You are English champion now. That Lonsdale belt, what will it mean to you?
It means the world to me, you know. I've seen a lot of people with the Vaughans with it. My good mate Paul Edwards, he was Georgie's, you know, George had him from the start, and he went on and won a British title. He's fighting for the title very soon, he's fighting for the English title. And, you know, to do what he's done, we're from the same street, we grew up in the same street, and he's a good friend of mine, to win a British title. For the Vaughan camp will be tremendous, and for the people who've backed me from day one, I think that's the only belt I haven't won, or the only belt I haven't boxed for, really.
There's no doubt about it. You know, he's got the potentials of a cracking fight. It's got the Manchester Liverpool derby tinge to it, just to make it that little bit more sweeter. It's going to be a good night overnight.
It's going to be a cracking night. You know, I mean, there's been a lot of stuff on Twitter being getting said and stuff like that. So I've just calmed it down now. I'm focusing on the fight. I've had a telling off my trainers to calm down on Twitter. The missus have told me to calm down on Twitter, but you know, that's just bad. It's banter to me. You know, it just goes one ear now the other. Me and Andy have got a lot of respect for each other. I've got a lot of respect for Joe Gallagher, the trainer. He's a good coach. You know, he's got a great camp out there, but you know, come fight night, we're on our own, me and Andy in the middle of the ring, and maybe the best man win.
Danny Matthews, British lightweight champion.
Definitely, Derry Mathews. I'm going to win the British title, without a doubt. You know, as I said before, he's never been a hard fight, he's never been cut, he's never been took in deep water, and I'm going to take him to places he's never been before, and, you know, hopefully, well, I know, I'm going to come out the better man and come out the winner.
And where does that win put you, other than being British champion? Is it, you know, start of another Derry Mathews?
It's the start of chapter three, isn't it? It's just, go on and go on and go on, but I wouldn't mind winning the British title outright, and I wouldn't mind having, I wouldn't say there's easy fights out there, but you know, I wouldn't mind a home defence once I win it, you know, and hands have gone on, well, an agreement that I'll beat Anthony Crolla, I signed for them for three fights, so they're not confident in them, they've made me sign three fight options on the fight, so you know, So that goes to prove how confident they are. They've got me signed down to make three defences of the British title. So I'm happy, you know, I'll just get on with this fight, and then maybe my manager, Stephen Vaughan, and I'll sit down with the Atoms, and we can plan the future.
And are people writing you off, Derry? Have you got everything to gain and Crolla everything to lose?
I've got nothing to gain. I've got nothing to lose. I've got it all to gain. I'm fighting him in his own yard where he grew up. You know, I've got a lot of supporters coming to me who I never let down. I'm always in a tremendous fight. And what have I got to lose, you know what I mean? I'm going to go in there, give it everything. And I know if I give it everything, I'll win a British title.
It's about the makings of a cracker.
It's going to be a cracker. Andy's a great fighter. I'll never say he's not a great fighter, but he's never been in a hard fight. April 21st, he's in the hardest fight of his life. Yeah.